chill spring of 1869, a great American general, the 18th President of the United States, met with his new cabinet for one of the first meetings of his new administration. Cabinet were two men who were fated to have a great struggle over a terrible question of peace or war. One was John A. Rawlins, Secretary of War. The other man was Hamilton Fish, Secretary of State, former Governor of New York State, former United States Senator. Hamilton Fish and General Rawlins were to fight an intense duel for control over the mind of President Ulysses Simpson Grant, the great Civil War hero.
The question, gentlemen, boils down to this. If we recognize the Cuban rebels, are we not likely to wind up at war with Spain? Is Cuba worth a war?
The time is 1869. In his struggle to avoid war, Hamilton Fish would gamble his reputation as an American diplomat.
Bancroft Davis, Undersecretary of State.
Mighty pleased to meet you, I'm sure.
I see by the President's card you're a personal friend, Mr. Brewster. Oh,
we've known the Grant family for years.
Yes.
Well, my daddy...
I can readily imagine. Well, now, Mr. Brewster, the choice of consulates is rather limited.
Oh. Well, my missus is kind of partial to England since she's of English stock. But personally, I like warm weather. I thought maybe a nice, dry, sunny spot in Italy would do us just fine. You know, someplace where we could get into Firenze easily.
Yes, yes. Well, it's a pity we don't have to have consulate in Florence. As a matter of fact, Italy has been in such a state of turmoil recently, Mr. Brewster, I don't think it's suitable for you.
Kind of dangerous, huh? Well, England's all right, I suppose, although I don't much like the English. Well, I mean, them recognizing the Johnny Rebs and all. I'll bet they're disappointed the South lost the war. But you can be sure we won't let them forget they backed the losing side, huh?
Yes, lucky for you, Mr. Brewster, you backed the winning side.
Huh?
Well, I mean, if Jefferson Davis or Robert E. Lee's name were on this card, it wouldn't do you much good in this office, would it?
Oh, by golly, that's a good one. Robert E. Lee, I get it. Hey, you got a real keen sense of humor, Mr. Fish, and people call you a stuffed shirt.
I wasn't aware that they did.
Oh, they'll change their minds when I tell them. Robert E. Lee, that's a corker.
Well, now, Mr. Brewster, if you'll leave it to me to find a suitable diplomatic post for you just at this moment.
Oh, sure, I understand. Yeah. But you can always get in touch with me at the Hotel Willard. That's where we're staying.
Good.
Me and my missus and my sister-in-law. Kind of taking in the sights before going to the continent.
Thank you for favoring us with a visit, Mr. Brewster.
Yes,
we'll be in touch.
Yes.
Oh.
sunny, dry spot in Italy. How many friends do you think the president has?
I wish they were all as harmless as Mr. Brewster. I've seen some frightening enough to raise hair on the back of a snake.
How many of these cards we have now?
24 or more. This is only the beginning. Mr. Secretary, may I ask you a personal question?
Certainly.
Why did you accept President Grant's offer of Secretary of State?
Well, Mr. Davis, you know my family has a long tradition of public service. But besides that, when the President of the United States asks you to serve, you don't refuse.
With all due respect, sir, I think you should have refused this post.
Well, men like Brewster all about...
I'm not referring to Brewster and people like that. I'm referring to a much more serious matter. May I speak frankly, sir?
Please do.
I know you to be an honest man. And in that respect, I consider you a unique member of this administration.
Mr. Davis,
I am speaking frankly and confidentially, sir. There are men close to the president who are determined to plunge this country into a war with Spain to annex Cuba. Well, not for the good of the United States, but for simple personal greed. They expect to make a great deal of money at the conclusion of that war.
That's a very serious accusation, Mr. Davis.
Sir, it is common knowledge that the Cuban rebels have a great deal of money, and that they are spending that money freely not only in New York, but in Washington. But what is not so commonly known is that they have issued a special bond, redeemable in gold. And they have given these bonds to Americans as bribes to support their government. There must be $10 or $20 million worth of those bonds in the hands of men in high places in Washington. Even in the House, the Senate.
I have heard those rumors, Mr. Davis. I don't believe them.
Spanish minister believes them. He's had private detectives tracking the recipients.
What good are bonds issued by a government without assets?
Once the government of the United States recognizes the Cuban Revolutionary Government, those bonds will be worth their full face amount, and the men who have accepted those bonds know it.
I don't believe the president would tolerate such a thing.
Grant is nothing if not tolerant. Well, Brewster represents the type of man that Grant puts his trust in, men who come to their post ill-equipped, incompetent.
What about Rawlins?
Rawlins? I don't deny that Rawlins was of invaluable aid to Grant during the war. Some say he saved Grant from oblivion at Vicksburg. However, this is peacetime. Rawlins has no place. Grant appointed him purely in an act of friendship.
Well, I don't think the president is going to lead us into a war with Spain over Cuba, merely to oblige a friend, Mr. Davis. Even a close personal friend.
Sir, I don't wish to be presumptuous, but only a man who knows nothing about Grant or Rawlins would say a thing like that.
I know what you recommend. But aside from my salary as Secretary of War, I have no income. You were aware of that when my friends from Galena gave me $1,000. That was pure and simple charity.
Well, perhaps the president could arrange a pension. Grant thinks highly of him.
I don't want to ask him for money. You know that.
There are the Cuban bonds.
Bliss, I told you. I cannot accept those bonds.
Why not? You believe the Cuban government should be recognized. You've publicly committed yourself to driving out every European power from the hemisphere. This is what you believe.
With all my heart.
Why not accept a grateful gift from the Cuban government? John, I'll be blunt. consumption is not a curable disease. Progressive, it's deadly. The best we can hope for is an arrest of the symptoms, but no cure. And in your case, the prognosis is not poor. It's negative. John, you will die of consumption. Perhaps in less than a year.
Stretching my legs, so I walked over.
Sit down. A damp evening.
It's going to be a hot, wet summer. I hate Washington summers. I'd like to travel this summer. Go up to Long Branch. Ever been there?
Yes. Yes, I have.
I love the sea. I sometimes think I should have been a sailor instead of a soldier. I sometimes think I should have been something else besides president.
I'm afraid we're going to be forced to go to war with Spain, Mr. Fish.
Is Cuba that important, Mr. President?
No, but the principle is. The principle that people ought to be free to run their own affairs, manage their own destinies. That's what our country's all about.
Then why didn't we allow the Confederacy to rebel?
Because this isn't a collection of states. It's a country. In the name of our country, the word that matters is not states. It's united. A lot of dead boys are moldering in the ground of this country just over that word. I killed some of them. John Rawlins and Admiral Ammon and Ben Butler and a whole lot of other people are urging me to recognize the Cuban rebels. And it's one short step from recognizing them to helping them. That's another short step from that to war. And I think the one thing that stands between us and war is you, Mr. Fish. Are you going to keep us out of war?
I would feel I had done the country a disservice if I did not, Mr. President. I did not become Secretary of State to engage this country in war.
Mr. Fish, I'll be candid with you. I knew very little about you when I invited you to join my cabinet. I understand you took the post with great reluctance.
That's true. There were reasons why I shouldn't have served. I'm 60 years of age. I've given many years of my life to public service. But besides that...
Go on. I'm not thin-skinned, especially.
Well, I had been warned that your administration would not be characterized by an abundance of men of good faith.
Is that a diplomatic way of saying I listen to my friends too much?
No man who didn't listen to his friends too much would say we have to go to war with Spain over Cuba.
I didn't say we have to. I don't want a war. But how are we going to stop it? Public sentiment favors the Cubans. And then we're expansionists. I think Cuba ought to be an American possession, don't you? I know Senator Sumner would like Canada to be part of the United States. But why not Cuba?
Because Cuba still has slavery. And you have just fought a war to abolish slavery, Mr. President. And because the price of annexing Cuba is a war with Spain. I don't think Cuba's worth a war, Mr. President. I don't think it's worth one single life.
my conviction.
Mr. Fish, you said I was a man with too many friends. May I compound that by adding you as a friend?
I would be deeply honored, Mr. President.
All right, then. Solve this Cuban mess for us. Pull a rabbit out of your hat, but give me a big, wriggling, lively rabbit I can show off, so we can cool some of the hotheads that are calling for war.
Mr. President?
Mr. Secretary of State.
We have, for the past several months, been discussing the problem of the Cuban Rebellion.
That's all we ever seem to do is discuss it.
This vexing problem is not simple, but I would now like to put before this body a serious and, I believe, most promising solution.
Go ahead, Mr. Fish. We're ready for anything.
The State Department, since late in May, has been involved in an intensive and secret series of conversations with the Spanish government. And we have finally come to an informal agreement with Spain on the following basis. One, Cuba is to be granted her independence, in exchange for which the rebel Cuban government shall pay the government of Spain a sum of money yet to be agreed upon. Two, the rebel Cuban government agrees to abolish slavery in Cuba. Three, an armistice shall be in effect during these negotiations. Four, the rebel Cuban government shall issue new bonds to finance this payment to Spain. Which new bonds shall fall due before all other obligations of the rebel Cuban government? Finally, the United States, with the consent of Congress, shall guarantee these new bonds. There are a few other minor stipulations, but these five clauses contain the heart of the agreement.
Mr. Fish, what it boils down to is that the Cuban rebels will buy their island from Spain.
Yes, sir.
And we guarantee the purchase price?
That is correct.
What guarantee do you have that the Spanish government will agree?
It has already agreed, Mr. Rowland. Of course, we still have to get an agreement as to the exact amount of money to be paid, but in the light of the vast sums of money being lost by both sides at present, I think we can get the agreement. And of course, the value of the human lives to be saved by such a cash agreement beyond reckoning.
Rabbit.
We have given the proposition considerable thought, Senor Fish. And I am happy to report the revolutionary government of Cuba is willing to accede to the terms of mediation.
You're being most reasonable, Senor Lemus.
Nor do I consider the sum excessive.
Then we can inform Madrid that $100 million is the sum to be considered, huh?
A practical question, Senor Fish. This proposed payment of $100 million is to be made through a special bond issue to be guaranteed by the United States government.
With the consent of Congress. Which I feel reasonably certain of obtaining.
Now, there was an earlier issue of bonds, Cuban Revolutionary Government bonds, in the amount of $20 million. Will the United States government guarantee these bonds as well?
No, sir, it will not. If the earlier bonds are to be paid, the new Cuban government will have to find the means to do it after they have paid off the new bonds.
You are a true American, Senor Fish.
In what sense?
You are an incurable optimist. But I pray that your optimism will be rewarded.
Well, nothing worthwhile was ever accomplished through pessimism, Senor Lemus.
Buena suerte.
That means that the bribe takers like Rawlins will have to wait at least 20 years to realize a dime on the first Cuban gold bonds.
Rawlins?
There's no question that he's accepted the bonds. I have it from an unimpeachable source.
So they're hoisting their own petard. Well, the wages of corruption are sometimes like the wages of sin. You have to wait till you're dead to collect.
John Rawlins has very little time to wait.
Senor Fish was explicit in the matter. He said that the Attorney General's office would stop all recruiting and all attempts to send troops to Cuba.
Now, you must make up your mind as to who your friends are. Now, let me remind you of something you may have forgotten. My demand to have European power removed from this hemisphere preceded your rebellion and your bonds by a good 2 years. Now, who is to say that Spain will be satisfied with 100 million? Why not 200 million? Why not 300? Once you have agreed to pay anything at all, then they are free to ask whatever they wish. And mark this, Senor Ramos. Hamilton Fish will put every pressure upon you and your government to accept it.
Senor Rawlins, we do not want to lose your valued friendship, believe me. What would you advise us to do?
You must not let up on your military operations. You must not agree to an armistice. In fact, you must fight harder now than you ever have before. Mount an invasion.
Invasion?
Yes. As large a force as you can possibly muster. Mr. President, do you realize that Fish is helping Spain by stopping all Cuban recruiting in the States? If you permit him to keep on with these negotiations, you will have sold out the people of Cuba, and you will have sold out the people of this country as well.
John, I can't push matters any harder.
You can. You can sign a proclamation recognizing the rebels as a belligerent government. That will put the pressure on Madrid.
The Spaniards are proud, John. They could put their backs up.
What are we to be concerned with here? Spanish pride? Or Cuba? And our own sense of what's decent, what's right, and what's fair. Hamilton Fish will let these negotiations drag on until Cuba is bled to death. It's in his nature to pussyfoot and hedge. Seen commanders like this in the field. You've had to remove men like that.
That's true.
You have already drafted a proclamation recognizing the rebels. What's become of it?
That's locked up in the safe at the State Department. Hamilton Fish and I are agreed we won't issue it unless we must.
Set a time limit for Mr. Fish. Otherwise, he will sit on it until hell freezes over. Mr. President, the American people look to you for action. Every day you delay destroys public confidence in your administration. I beg of you, set a time limit on these negotiations.
All right, John. Take a message to Hamilton Fish, Department of State.
If our minister in Madrid has not received an entirely satisfactory reply, you will break off all negotiations. I can see John Rawlins' fine hand in this.
an entirely satisfactory reply. That is vague enough to gain you another month's negotiations.
It's vague enough to ease Grant's conscience. It doesn't help me. How can I stop it now? How can anybody stop it? Like trying to stop a tidal wave with a child's bucket and a shovel full of sand. John Rawlins, Orville Babcock, Admiral Ammon, and the rest are going to push Grant into war. Well, the Congress wants it. The Senate wants it. The press wants it. Every single public meeting ends with a call for war.
If there were time to delay, time to put off the decision, Spain would negotiate. Otherwise, she'd have to go to war with us, and she knows she'd lose that war, and I know as surely as I know the tide will fall that Spain would have to agree, but I cannot make Grant wait.
I delayed a decision on Cuba until the cabinet meeting today because of you.
The choice is peace or war, Mr. President. Rawlins wants war, I want peace.
Everyone wants peace, even John Rawlins. But John recognizes that moral compulsions can take us into war.
No one can ever convince me that war is ever waged because of moral compulsions.
Never?
Necessary causes, perhaps. Not moral ones.
Hamilton, have you ever considered what history will make of you?
I suppose it's crossed my mind.
I don't think it has. If you had any ambition to go down in history, you would not be opposing this war.
What would I be doing?
What thousands of good Americans have been urging. Take a stand with the rebels. To be called a hero.
Well, Mr. President, somehow I just can't accept that the Secretary of State deserves to be called a hero for helping his country into war.
A successful war, Hamilton. That's the difference. A war that's won is the war that turns commanders into great battlefield strategists, politicians into statesmen. The price of historical position is success. Win, and you'll be remembered. Lose, and you'll become a footnote. Well, here's a war that we can win. And it's a war that can secure your place in history. The man who won Cuba for the United States.
Mr. President, may I recall to your mind a phrase you once uttered? Let us have peace.
There's nothing more unfair than throwing a man's word back into his face. Of course I want peace. But wanting is not simply enough. You must actively seek it. And seeking peace, you may have to risk war. A war that everyone seems to be agreed we can win without much bloodshed, without much risk.
Yes. Well, I just don't feel better about it knowing that it's a war that can be won easily.
You don't think like a soldier?
No, I don't. I'm not a soldier. I'm trying to be a diplomat.
A very high-minded diplomat.
I take it you meant that as a compliment, Mr. President, but somehow I can't help feeling it sounded like a rebuke.
I'm sorry, Hamilton, but popular government depends upon popular support. I can't afford to split Congress and the administration down the middle. There are too many people in and out of Congress not on your side.
Are you on my side, Mr. President?
I cannot afford to be on your side and withstand every pressure. Not indefinitely.
Then you're going to recognize the Cuban belligerents, despite the fact that they have no army, no navy, no tax revenues, no regularly elected or organized government, in fact, no qualification whatever for nationhood.
I will not listen to any further private arguments, Hamilton. The matter will be resolved at the cabinet meeting today.
I cannot attend that meeting, Mr. President, because I cannot be party to such an agreement.
I don't want to lose you from my cabinet, Hamilton. At 12 noon, I shall convene the cabinet in the first session since July. I shall entertain discussions on Cuba. John Rawlins will be there, even if he has to get off his deathbed. If you want to come there and fight it out once more, I will listen. But I make no commitment beyond that. Good morning, Hamilton.
Left is for you to resign.
The president may not have made up his mind yet.
Of course he has. That pack at the White House has been after him for months. They know the negotiations are stalemated.
I can guess about the negotiations. They can't possibly know for certain.
Of course they know. Every communication between yourself and Madrid has fallen into their hands. There is an immense fortune at stake. Do you think they're going to let you stop them from getting it? They've lied, cheated, swindled, stolen for it, and now they almost have it in the palm of their hand. Do you know what those bonds are worth in New York at this very moment? Almost full face value. Bond traders in New York know what the cabinet will decide.
That's all the more reason for going to that cabinet meeting.
You've lost before you've begun. They have the president in their pocket. They have the president's proclamation signed, and it will be issued, and nothing you can do will stop them. I beg of you, sir. Hand in your resignation, or they'll find a way to blacken your name and force you out of the cabinet.
How can they blacken my name?
What is to prevent them from suggesting that some of the $100 million sale price might find its way into your pocket? They're not above suggesting that. I have prepared a resignation. Do you agree?
Simply sign it.
Why risk your reputation serving an administration that is rotten with corruption and bent on war?
Because, damn it, it's my country, too.
And because there are such things as right and justice. Dull and stodgy as they may appear, we cannot run out just because it's more comfortable or popular to wave a flag. Send the lads off to war and shout hurrah. Two broadsides and the Spanish fleet goes to the bottom. One charge up the beach and it's all over. Then run the flag up at the top and sit down and count our Cuban bonds.
We cannot, because it's our country, too.
It's not the sole property of John Rawlins, General Babcock, Admiral Lamon, and the rest of the bondholders. It's our country, and they're sending our countrymen to die for their profit. Not while I can draw a breath.
Thank you, gentlemen. Please be seated and keep your coats off. John, are you sure you feel well enough to be here?
I'm here, Mr. President.
Don't be foolish. If you're worried about our making a decision on Cuba, you needn't. We can put it off until you feel stronger.
You must not put off a decision.
Gentlemen, I realize Washington is no place in which to gather during August, so I propose we keep our meeting down to the essentials.
Mr. President,
I recognize the Secretary of War.
If we are to deal only with essentials, then let us deal with the only essential matter before this cabinet, before this government, before, in fact, the whole Western Hemisphere. And that, gentlemen, is the joke. The hideous, monstrous joke of an American Secretary of State being gulled.
President, I protest.
Gulled by a Spanish swindler. A fraud. A fake. Gulled into believing that their government desires our good offices when they desire nothing of the kind.
The Secretary of War takes liberties with the truth.
Sir, what do you know of the truth? You have been swindled and defrauded and cheated and made to look like a fool. The Spaniards, sir, have hoodwinked you. There is not an intelligent person in Europe or the United States who does not already know the truth. The truth, which has been staring us all in the faces for weeks, for months, is that the Spanish government never seriously entertained a negotiation. Fish has so blindly, so trustingly, so witlessly been pursuing. First, they asked for money. And when it was granted them, they asked for disarmament. And when it was demonstrated to them that disarming the Cubans could not be a one-sided affair, they found other reasons to delay. They bleed the rebels while they fatten their own forces, and for this purpose, they pretend to negotiate, and they manipulate the United States Secretary of State in this grisly game. Everyone is on to that game. But Mr. Hamilton Fish, where are Mr. Fish's brains? Where is his judgment? Where are his eyes that he sees nothing that is so plain to every other eye? Gentlemen, Cuba cries out to us from her misery, from her pain. These are men who turn to us for aid, for assistance, for succor, because we are the authors of human liberty in this hemisphere. Did we not suffer the same cruel oppression as colonials? Did we not know the quartering of foreign troops in our homes? Spaniard is a crueler master than the English ever were. The Spaniard does not reason, he burns. He does not persuade. He murders. He does not rule. He robs. He does not negotiate. He lies. Mr. President, I have been your adjutant. I think you will excuse me for being earnest.
Certainly. And you are still my adjutant.
President.
Yes, Mr. Fish.
The Secretary of War is an eloquent man. I am no less moved by his appeal because he called me a butt and a dupe and a fool. Possibly I am all these. But whether or no, if a man is to serve his country, he must be willing to be called names. In fact, sometimes the measure of his usefulness is the variety and intensity of names that he's called. Maybe in Madrid they're calling me even worse. But I'm indifferent. That doesn't hurt me. Nothing people say can hurt me. Only what they do can hurt. Is there any man here who values his good name above the good of the United States? Is there any man here who treasures his popularity above the good of the United States? No, I think not. Then why should any man here expect me to treasure my good name and reputation above the safety and integrity of the country I love? Or why should I concern myself with these names I may be called by politicians and warmongers? So I'm deaf to them. As I am deaf to the outraged cries of the Congress and the public and the popular press. According to Secretary Rawlins, I'm equally deaf to the outraged cries of the suffering Cubans. I hear nothing. Is that it? Or am I listening to another voice, another sound, another drum? I'm listening to a voice that says, let us have peace. And I say, we can have peace. We are willing to negotiate, to wait, to be patient, to understand the problems we face, and not insist on swift, simple solutions. A dozen nations we could defeat without a struggle. Why not launch wars against all of them? Why not? We wouldn't be the first nation to pursue such a course, Mr. President. As for history, sir, the history of the human race is blighted by the names of such nations, such conquerors. Men on horseback. I am in no position to say that the negotiations will be successful, but by the same mark, no other man can say with certainty that they have failed. We cannot accept failure simply because the popular press has accepted it. We cannot accept failure simply because Americans who wish to profit from war wish to accept it. Mr. President, I shall negotiate along this line if it takes all summer.
Thank you for reminding me, Mr. Fish. Gentlemen, I hereby adjourn this meeting.
Mr. Rawlins, will you tell me what is in that note from the President?
It's a communication from the President to the Secretary of State, Mr. Rawlins. If he wanted you to know the contents, he would have made it public.
Mr. Fish, I beg you, not as Secretary of War, but as another fellow creature, tell me what is in that note.
The President has decided to withdraw all offers to mediate unless negotiations with Spain are successfully concluded by the 1st of October.
1st of October?
Then you've won. I've won another delay. Let me tell you, another round like that, Rawlins will win.
Grant was deeply moved.
Of course he was. Rawlins talked his way onto Grant's staff with a speech.
He was very persuasive.
I would be as persuasive if I had as many unredeemed Cuban gold bonds in my strong box.
I don't believe that story.
I do. I've heard it from too many people.
Do you know that my brother was approached in New York and offered a fortune if he would find out if the president's proclamation, which was in my strongbox, was to be implemented?
How did they know it was in your strongbox?
There isn't anything that happens in the cabinet meeting that isn't for sale, including impassioned speeches for poor little Cuba.
Bancroft, no matter what you think about Rawlins, the man is sincere.
John A. Rawlins is a poor man of modest family background. He's a sick man, possibly dying. His wife is expecting a child. I'm sure he doesn't have a dollar in this world put aside for his family. Now, under such circumstances, and offered enough money, a mute could become eloquent.
Whether he took the bonds or not, there is a passion for liberty in John Rawlins that cannot be bought merely with money. That's what makes him so formidable. And he is not yet lost. I want Grant's note cabled to Sickles in Madrid. I want you to add that in order to avoid bloodshed and devastation, we must have an early decision. Unless accepted, the offer will be withdrawn October 1.
October 1. John Rawlins has collapsed. They believe he may be dying.
Ladies and gentlemen, the soul of President Grant's cabinet is gone.
Just a moment ago, Mr. President.
Did you know he was only 39 years old? Only 39.
I have a confidential communication, sir. An inventory of the personal effects of John Rawlins disclosed that he held $28,000 worth of Cuban bonds.
It's true.
The physical proof exists. What action do you wish to take?
John Rawlins is beyond doing any more harm to the country. His widow and his children could be injured. There's no profit in malice, Mr. Davis. Let it rest.
Hamilton Fish served 7 more years as Secretary of State in Grant's cabinet. His diplomacy resulted in the abolition of slavery in Cuba. He established the principle of non-aggression, which became the keystone of American foreign policy. Hamilton Fish did not yield to the cry of war and believed the ways of peace, even when they are longer and more difficult and more trying to follow, are worthy of the best efforts of man.
These stories of past courage teach, they can offer hope, and they can provide inspiration. But they cannot supply courage itself. For this, each man must look into his own soul.
The use of this additional story of a courageous American was approved by President Kennedy for this series. In a moment, a preview of the next episode.